Establish legal admissibility. Significant data sources have been identified based on the digital evidence relevant to mitigating the known business risk scenarios. With the collection requirements understood and documented, mechanisms must be implemented to preserve gathered digital evidence as authentic records to uphold legal admissibility. At this stage of implementing a digital forensic program, organizations will have a grasp on the totality of digital evidence available for proactive collection and have determined which of it, with the organization's collection requirements defined, steps must now be taken to implement a series of controls to guarantee that the secure preservation of digital evidence is maintained when it is being gathered from relevant data sources. These steps are important for organizations to establish so they can ensure that data has been preserved as authentic records and cannot be disputed when admitted to a court of law as digital evidence. Legal admissibility. Essentially, admissibility is the determination of whether information that is presented before the trier of fact 1, i.e., judge, jury, is worthy to be accepted in court of law as evidence. Generally, in order for digital evidence to be admissible in a court of law, it must be proven to have relevance, i.e., material, factual, and is not overshadowed by invalidating considerations, i.e., unfairly prejudicial, hearsay 2. Within the legal system, there are a set of rules that is used as precedents for governing whether, when, how, and for what purpose digital evidence can be placed before a trier of fact. Traditionally, the legal system viewed digital evidence as being hearsay because its authenticity could not be proven, beyond a reasonable doubt, to be factual. However, exceptions do exist under the Federal Rules of Evidence 803-6, where digital evidence can be admitted into a legal proceeding only if it demonstrates records of regularly conducted activity as a business record, such as an act, event, condition, opinion, or diagnosis. In order for digital evidence to qualify under this exception, organizations have to demonstrate that their business records are authentic, reliable, and trustworthy. As stated in the Federal Rules of Evidence, in order to attain these qualifying properties, organizations must be able to demonstrate that their business records was created as a regular practice of that activity, were created at or near the time by, or from information transmitted by, someone with knowledge, have been preserved in the course of a regularly conducted activity of a business, organization, occupation, or calling, are being presented by the custodian, another qualified witness, by a certification that complies with either Rule 902-11 or Rule 902-12, or with a statute-granting certification, do not show that the source of information or method or circumstances of its preparation indicate a lack of trustworthiness. Furthermore, even if a business record qualifies under these exceptions, organizations must still determine if the business record falls within the context of being either technology-generated data that has been created and is being maintained as a result of programmatic processes or algorithms, e.g., log files. These records fall within the rules of hearsay exception on the basis that the data is proven to be authentic as a result of properly functioning programmatic processes or algorithms. Technology-stored data that has been created and is being maintained as a result of user input and interactions, e.g., word processor document. These records fall within the rules of hearsay exception on the basis that author of the data is reliable, trustworthy, and has not altered it. Even if a business record meets the above criteria for being admissible as digital evidence, there is the potential that it will be challenged during legal proceedings. The basis for these contests is directed at the authenticity of the data and whether it has been altered or damaged either after it was created or as a result of interactions and exchanges with the data. In an effort to reduce these oppositions, the Federal Rules of Evidence 1002 described the need for proving, beyond a reasonable doubt, that the trustworthiness of digital evidence must be demonstrated through the production of the authentic and original business record. Meeting this rule requires that organizations demonstrate their due diligence in preserving the authenticity of the original data source through the implementation of safeguards, precautions, and controls to guarantee that business records can be admitted as digital evidence during legal proceeding. Preservation challenges collecting business records is not as straightforward as it seems. As an example, where organizations operate in multiple jurisdictions and countries, they are bound in each location to multiple factors that determine how they can effectively preserve their business records. First and foremost, organizations need to answer two preliminary questions before determining how they will guarantee the authenticity of their business records. Can digital evidence be gathered without interfering with business operations and function? The overall strategy for implementing digital forensic readiness, summarized as the ability to maximize potential use of digital evidence while minimizing investigative costs, includes an objective to gather admissible digital evidence without interrupting business operations and functions. Typically, forensic investigations are performed in reaction to an event and requires the assistance of several support resources to gather relevant digital evidence. In some instances, this reactive approach commonly results in roadblocks where business records are not readily available, which requires support resources to be removed from the day-to-day business operations to assist. Where gathering business records has been identified as beneficial to digital forensic readiness, organizations need to assess the work effort required of resources to implement the proactive collection requirements while not impeding their day-to-day business operations. Can digital evidence be gathered legally? Aligned with the overall strategy for implementing digital forensic readiness noted above, another objective of gathering admissible digital evidence is to do it in a way that does not violate any laws or regulations. This determination should not be done without obtaining legal advice to ensure that the evidence collection requirements are met and upheld. In some countries, there are relevant laws around data protection, privacy, and human rights that will dictate what business records can be collected and, if it can be collected, where or how it is stored. For organizations to ensure that they demonstrate a reasonable assurance, the collection of all business records must adhere to all applicable laws or regulations. Preservation strategies. Having answered these questions and knowing the constraints around what, how, and where business records can be gathered, organizations can now implement strategies to ensure they are compliant with applicable laws and regulations. As these strategies are being identified and developed, it is important to keep in mind that they should encompass a series of complementary administrative, physical, and technical security controls. Administrative controls. Before any type of technical or physical security controls can be implemented, there must first and foremost be a foundational governance structure in place. This governance structure is established in the form of administrative controls that include the creation and approval of organizational policies, standards, and guidelines that support the preservation of digital evidence authenticity and integrity. Policies. These documents are created with the intent of building a formal blueprint that describes the goals for preserving digital evidence. They are designed to provide generalized direction that allows organizations to consider any subsequent physical or technical security controls that are required to safeguard their digital evidence. Guidelines. Building off of the policy documentation, guidelines can now be created as documents that provide recommendations for how to implement the generalized direction set previously. The context of these documents is intended to be subjective, where organizations will use the recommendations as a way of gathering requirements for how to preserve the authenticity and integrity of their digital evidence. Standards. Following the interpretation of the guidelines, standard documents are created to outline the minimum level of technical and physical security controls necessary. These documents should contain the exact configurations, architectures, and specifications for implementing technical and physical security controls in support of policies and guidelines. Procedures. The previously noted administrative controls do not have direct oversight of interactions with collected digital evidence. Through the implementation of standard operating procedures, the exchanges and interfaces between administrators, operators, and investigators and digital evidence are documented. Technical controls. Even if a business record meets the criteria for being admissible during a legal proceeding, organizations will still be faced with the challenge of proving it has not been altered or damaged after it was created or as a result of interactions and exchanges with it. As a means to mitigate the potential for the authenticity of business records being challenged in a court of law, organizations should implement several technical controls to guarantee that business records can be admitted as digital evidence. Understanding that every organization's business environment is different, at a minimum, the following technical controls must be in place to ensure secure preservation of business records as digital evidence. Storage. Security. Organizations can select any different type of electronic storage medium to preserve their collected digital evidence, such as hard drives or backup tapes. Regardless of how the information is being stored, organizations must consider the data at rest for implications by ensuring the preserved digital evidence is not exposed if unauthorized access to the storage medium is gained. Through the use of cryptography, inactive data can be protected through one of the following implementations. Full disk encryption applies cryptographic algorithms to the physical storage medium, regardless of its content, to encrypt all information. Encrypted file system applies cryptographic algorithms at the file system level to encrypt logical data sets. The use of disk encryption does not replace the need for file encryption in all situations. In some instances, the two can be used in conjunction with each other to provide a more layered defense to guaranteeing the authenticity and integrity of digital evidence. Integrity monitoring. All types of digital data, whether technology generated or technology stored, are prone to issues of trustworthiness where the content and context of the information cannot be easily validated and is often challenged for its authenticity. These issues of data integrity and authenticity are some of the contributors that render business records inadmissible as digital evidence in a court of law. However, organizations can get the upper hand on the matter of data integrity and authenticity through the use of solutions such as file integrity monitoring. With these technologies, validation of both system and data integrity can be achieved by authenticating specific data properties of the current data state against the known good state of the data. Examples of data properties that can be used in as part of this verification and validation include the following: subject permissions and entitlements, actual data content of files, metadata attributes, i.e., size, creation date, time, cryptographic values. Implementation of integrity monitoring is an essential security control to guarantee the authenticity and integrity of business records as digital evidence. Cryptographic algorithms. Every interaction with and exchange of digital information introduces the potential of that data being modified, whether knowingly or unintentionally. Proving the authenticity of digital information to the original source and maintaining that level of integrity throughout a forensic investigation is critical for it to be admissible as digital evidence. Cryptography supports many information security-centric services, such as authentication and non-repudiation, that are fundamental to the digital forensic science discipline and digital evidence management, as discussed in Chapter Evidence Management. Examples of common cryptographic algorithms that are used in digital forensics as part of evidence management are the following. The message digest algorithm family, e.g., MD5, is commonly used during a forensic investigation to generate a unique cryptographic identifier of files, data streams, and other digital evidence. However, in 2010, researchers were able to generate collisions where the same 128-bit hexadecimal value could be generated for two distinctively different pieces of digital information. The Shaw family, e.g., SHA-2, is also used during forensic investigations to generate a unique cryptographic identifier for digital evidence. From the collisions identified within specific versions of the message digest algorithm family, specifically MD5, the SHA family of hash functions has become popular as a means of establishing the integrity and authenticity of digital evidence. Cyclic redundancy check 7 is commonly used during the forensic duplication of digital evidence to detect modifications to the underlying data. Using these calculations allows forensic investigators to use the duplicate data during analysis instead of risking potential contamination of the original evidence source. When implemented correctly, cryptography provides organizations with an acceptable level of assurance that the integrity of collected business records can be proven when authenticated to the original data source. Remote logging technology generated data stored on local systems, such as security or audit log files, is inevitably more vulnerable to being 1. Manipulated to conceal activities or events or 2. Planted to incriminate other individuals. These data integrity issues lessen the credibility of the information and render it inadmissible as evidence in a court of law. As a best practice, remote logging capabilities should be leveraged to redirect the logging of technology-generated data off local systems and into a centralized remote logging infrastructure. Enforcing this safeguard will reduce the likelihood of data tampering on local systems and maintain the integrity of technology-generated data as admissible digital evidence. Secure delivery. Where remote logging capabilities exist, organizations must consider the data in transit 8 implications for collected digital evidence. Regardless of whether information is traveling across a public or private network, there is a need to ensure the secure delivery of digital evidence to maintain its authenticity and integrity. Network communications are, in general, insecure where information traveling across them can readily be accessed or modified by unauthorized subjects if appropriate controls are not in place. Knowing this, organizations should be concerned with the confidentiality and integrity of digital evidence as it is being collected into their remote logging solutions. As a countermeasure, organizations should implement an encrypted communication channel using, as an example, Internet Protocol Security 9 to mitigate the risk of data in transit security concerns. Physical controls. Generally, physical security controls are designed to control and protect an organization's physical assets, i.e., building, systems, etc., by reducing the risk of damage or loss. As organizations design their approach to ensure the secure preservation of digital evidence, they must take into account the costs of building, operating, and maintaining physical security controls that work in conjunction with their administrative and technical security controls. While physical security controls may not always have the same direct interaction with digital evidence that technical controls have, they provide an additional layer of defense to safeguard the physical medium, i.e., tapes, hard drives, where digital evidence is stored. Physical security controls indirectly contribute to preserving the authenticity and integrity of digital evidence as implemented in one of the following categories. Deter. The goal of these physical security controls is to convince potential intruders and attackers that the likelihood of success is low because of strong defenses. Typically, the implementation of deterrent security controls are found in the combined use of physical barriers, i.e., walls, surveillance, i.e., closed caption television, CCTV, and lighting, i.e., spotlights. Crime prevention through environmental design. Crime prevention through environmental design, CPTED, is an approach to planning and developing physical security controls that use natural or environmental surroundings to reduce the opportunities for crime. As part of a comprehensive approach to guaranteeing the authenticity and integrity of digital evidence, examples of CPTED controls that can be implemented include, but are not limited to, natural surveillance such as implementing lighting designed to illuminate points of interest that do not generate glare or blind spots, natural access controls such as multi-level fencing to control access and enhance visibility, natural territorial reinforcements such as restricting activities to defined areas through the use of signage detect. Generally, detective controls are intended to discover and interrupt potential intruders and attackers before an incident or event occurs. Optimally, these controls should be implemented to reveal the presence of potential intruders and attackers while they are collecting information about how they can gain access to the physical medium where digital evidence is being stored. While it also plays a part in the deterrence of potential intruders and attackers, the use of CCTV is one of the most common physical controls for discovering an incident or event. Additionally, physical alarm systems and sensors can be used in combination with other types of controls, i.e., barriers, guards, to trigger a response when a breach has been detected. Deny identical to the use of authentication and authorization mechanisms to control logical access to systems and data, the same type of restrictive security controls must be used to deny physical access to the organization's assets. The primary objective of these physical controls is to deny potential intruders and attackers the ability to cause damage to systems and information. Within the context of preserving authenticity and integrity, examples of physical controls that can be used to deny access to collected digital evidence including, but are not limited, constructing secure storage facilities, such as lockers and restricted areas, that have true floor-to-ceiling walls, entrances that are constructed of material resistant to tampering and have internally facing hinges mechanisms to control and restrict access into secure lockers and restricted areas, such as lock and key, biometric scanner, or card badge readers. Delay where the implementation of physical security controls is unable to deter or detect potential intruders and attackers, such as having obtained a key that provides access into the secure storage area. Additional controls must ensure that their ability to easily gain access to digital evidence is delayed. Typically, these types of controls are the last line of defense when all previous implementation, deter, detect, delay, have failed to deliver the level of protection that they were intended for. Examples of how these security controls provide the last line of defense in physical protecting digital evidence include the following: placing secure lockers inside restricted areas that located away from the exterior of the building and requiring multiple checkpoints in order to gain access, requiring security guards to conduct searches and inspection of people, parcels, and vehicles as they leave buildings. Implementing physical safeguards provides organizations with a layer of security controls complementary to their administrative and technical controls. Not only do these physical security controls help to guarantee the authenticity and integrity of collected digital evidence, but it also support data protection requirements as part of the overall evidence management lifecycle. Summary: in order for business records to be admissible in legal proceedings, organizations must prove its authenticity by meeting specific criteria that direct rules for digital evidence. Through a layered implementation of safeguards, precautions, and controls that encompass the administrative, technical, and physical requirements for ensuring secure evidence preservation, organizations can guarantee that their business records can be admitted as digital evidence during legal proceedings. Thanks for watching. Establish secure storage and handling. When digital evidence is preserved in long-term or offline storage, it must be done so securely and be available when required. Regardless of the storage option used, the authenticity, confidentiality, and integrity of digital evidence must always be maintained in a highly available approach. Taking into account the safeguards and controls implemented to ensure collected digital evidence is admissible in a court of law, organizations must now determine how they will uphold these requirements as their digital evidence is being handled by several individuals and technologies. Likewise, as digital evidence is being transferred from one storage facility to another, such as long-term or offline storage, consideration must be given to ensure the data is securely preserved and readily available when needed. Establishing a governance framework over the handling and storage of digital evidence can be achieved by following the traditional approach of implementing complementary administrative, technical, and physical controls. Through the combination of these different controls in a layered fashion, organizations can ensure that their digital evidence will be handled correctly and stored securely. Secure storage attributes storage solutions such as an enterprise data warehouse (EDW) provides a centralized repository for aggregating digital evidence from multiple data sources. While it can be complex to implement, when done correctly, an EDW can generate significant benefits such as allowing digital evidence to be analyzed over a longer period of time for improved data mining and analytics. Having identified the safeguards required to maintain admissibility, organizations must now determine how to properly implement these controls to ensure that their digital evidence is being handled correctly throughout its entire life cycle, and that its authenticity and integrity are maintained as it is transferred between different storage facilities. Least privilege access, 1. Even though the modern threat landscape has changed, the delivery channels and attack vectors used by potential intruders and attackers continue to rely on the absence or weakness in both system and application access controls. In the context of admissibility in a court of law, the deficiencies in strong access controls are a blueprint for disaster when it comes to preserving the authenticity and integrity of digital evidence in secure storage. One of the fundamental cornerstones in the information security discipline is the concept of applying the principle of least privileged access. Exercising rigid controls over subjects that have administrative access into storage solutions housing digital evidence is critical. Without enforcing the use of least privileged access to these secure storage facilities, organizations cannot demonstrate admissibility in a court of law because the potential for unauthorized subject access puts into question the authenticity and integrity of their digital evidence. End-to-end cryptography. Cryptography supports several information security-centric services that are fundamental to the digital forensic discipline. Supporting several use cases for preserving digital evidence, examples of how cryptography can be applied were identified as data at rest controls, used to guarantee that unauthorized access to the storage medium does not expose the digital evidence, e.g., full disk encryption, or data in transit control, used for securing the transmission of digital evidence across any type of network infrastructure, e.g., Internet Protocol Security. Additionally, following along with the principles of least privilege access, digital evidence being stored should only be readable by those authorized. Through the use of cryptography, organizations can achieve a much stronger data-in-use security control mechanism that will allow for the authenticity and integrity of the digital evidence to be maintained. As digital evidence is being collected, it should be encrypted, using a mechanism such as a secret key, to help enforce the principle of least privilege and restrict access to only those authorized subjects. As an example, while the application of an encrypted file system (EFS) contributes to the protection of data at rest, it also provides data in use controls where only those users in possession of the secret key can access and read the digital evidence. Integrity checking. Integrity monitoring is an essential security control to guarantee the authenticity and integrity of digital evidence. With the known good state of digital evidence captured, ongoing verification and validation must be implemented to ensure that no alteration to preserved digital evidence has been made. When digital evidence is being preserved in a storage solution such as an EDW, integrity checks should be scheduled in alignment with the organization requirements for regulatory compliance and to effectively demonstrate legal admissibility. However, if digital evidence has been transferred into offline storage, such as backup tapes, routinely performing integrity checks cannot be easily achieved. In this situation, organizations must take an alternate approach to preserving the authenticity and integrity of their digital evidence as follows. 1. Prior to digital evidence being transferred to offline storage, an integrity check must be completed by comparing the known good state, set number 1, to the current state of the digital evidence, set number 2, through a cryptographic hash values such as the message digest algorithm family 8, e.g., MD5, or the secure hashing algorithm family 9, e.g., SHA-2. 2. Once the initial integrity checking is completed, set number 2 of hash values must be maintained for the duration of the transfer process for use in subsequent integrity checking after digital evidence has been stored on the offline storage. 3. After all digital evidence have been transferred to offline storage, a new set of hash values, set number 3, is produced and compared against set number 2 to guarantee the authenticity and integrity of digital evidence has been preserved. Physical security controls are designed to control and protect an organization's assets, i.e., people, building, systems, etc., by reducing the risk of harm, damage, or loss. While physical security controls may not always have the same direct interaction with digital evidence that technical controls have, they provide layers of defense that deter, detect, deny, and delay potential intruders and attackers from accessing digital evidence preserved in any type of storage solution. Where digital evidence is preserved in a storage solution, physical security controls are focused on reducing the risk of unauthorized access to the infrastructure housing the digital evidence. However, if digital evidence has been transferred into offline storage, such as backup tapes, the scope of physical security controls extends beyond protecting only the infrastructure. Digital evidence housed in offline storage is subject to the same requirement for demonstrating authenticity and integrity in order for it to be admissible in a court of law. For example, the Good Practices Guide for Computer-Based Electronic Evidence, developed by the Association of Chief of Police Officers (ACPO) in the United Kingdom, was created with 4 overarching principles that must be followed when handling evidence in order to maintain evidence authenticity. Principle number 1, no action taken by law enforcement agencies or their agents should change data held on a computer or storage media which may subsequently be relied upon in court. Principle number 2, in circumstances where a person finds it necessary to access original data held on a computer or on storage media, that person must be competent to do so and be able to give evidence explaining the relevance and the implications of their actions. Principle number 3, an audit trail or other record of all processes applied to computer-based electronic evidence should be created and preserved. An independent third party should be able to examine those processes and achieve the same result. Principle number 4, the person in charge of the investigation, the case officer, has overall responsibility for ensuring that the law and these principles are adhered to. When digital evidence has been transferred to offline storage such as backup tape, a chain of custody for this new storage medium must be established to guarantee its authenticity and integrity by tracking where it came from, where it went after seizure, and who handled it for what purpose. From this point forward, the chain of custody must accompany the offline storage and be maintained throughout the lifetime of the evidence. A chain of custody template has been provided as a reference in the templates section of this book. Furthermore, tapes should be stored using physical security controls that are intended to deny or delay potential intruders and attackers access to digital evidence. Achieving these layers of defenses can be accomplished by implementing the following physical security controls. Offline storage medium, such as backup tape, should be placed in an evidence bag that, at a minimum, supports the following characteristics. Bags contain a secure pouch to store the media and an externally accessible pouch for accompanying documentation. Proper labeling is affixed to correctly and efficiently identify the contents. Tamper-proof tape or locking mechanism is used to seal evidence inside. Chain of custody is placed in the externally accessible pouch. Physical access to digital evidence in offline storage must also be controlled following the same security principles of least privilege access. Once digital evidence has been properly sealed in evidence bags, these bags should be stored in a secure locker, safe, or library for long-term retention. It is important that at all times the chain of custody is updated to demonstrate ownership and location of the digital evidence. Administrative Governance Foundation's forensic viability can only be accomplished when digital evidence has been tracked and protected right from the time it was created and meets the requirements for legal admissibility throughout its entire life cycle. Although technical and physical security controls have a more direct contribution to the secure handling and storage of digital evidence, they cannot be effective unless there is an organizational requirement to adhere to. Therefore, to guarantee that digital evidence is forensically viable, organizations must have an established governance framework in place to ensure the collection, preservation, and storage of digital evidence is done properly. Ultimately, the objective of this governance framework is to establish direction on how the organization will preserve the authenticity and integrity of their digital evidence. Management, with involvement from key stakeholders such as legal, privacy, security, and human resources, must work together to define a series of documents that describe exactly how the organization will go about achieving these goals. Within the context of guaranteeing forensic viability of digital evidence, governance documentation should be created to address the following areas: personnel provide continuous training and awareness regarding the governance framework to all stakeholders involved in the collection, preservation, and storage of digital evidence. As acknowledgement of their adherence with the governance framework, stakeholders should be required to sign the necessary document to indicate their understanding of and commitment to them. Management, legal, privacy, security, and human resources should all be involved to ensure that these signed documents can be legally enforced. Require enhanced background checks to be routinely conducted for personnel who have access to digital evidence. Evidence storage document all operational aspects of the digital evidence storage solutions and facilities, including, but not limited to, normal operations and maintenance, scheduled backups, and error handling. Provide clear guidance and direction regarding the installation and updates to hardware and software components. Ensure storage solutions are designed and architected to meet the requirement and specification of their intended business strategy and/or function. Enforce the principle of least privilege access and implement the use of multi-factor authentication mechanism including, something you have, e.g., smart card, something you know, e.g., password, something you are, e.g., fingerprint. Apply a layered defense in-depth approach to physical security using a combination of control that are designed to deter, detect, deny, and delay potential intruders and attackers. Evidence handling apply integrity monitoring and checks to ensure digital evidence has not been tampered or modified from its no good and authenticated state. Prohibit the alteration or deletion of original source data. Restrict the storage of, transmission of, and access to digital evidence without the use of cryptographic encryption. Enforce the principle of least privilege access to only authorized personnel. Ensure that the long-term storage of digital evidence uses any form of storage medium that is write once read many, worm, seal digital evidence in appropriate containers, i.e., evidence bag, safe, to preserve authenticity and integrity during long-term storage. Define the long-term retention and recovery strategies for digital evidence. Incident and investigation response require that each incident and investigation is tracked and reported separately. Ensure that digital evidence used is proven to be authentic to the original source. Assurance controls require routinely audits and control assessments are conducted. Essentially, the culture and structure of each organization influences how these governance documents are created. Regardless of where, internationally, business is conducted or the size of the organization, there are five simple principles that should be followed as generic guidance for achieving a successful governance framework. Keep it simple, all documentation should be as clear and concise as possible. The information contained within each document should be stated as briefly as possible without omitting any critical pieces of information. Where documentation is drawn out and wordy, it is typically more difficult to understand, less likely to be read, and harder to interpret for implementation. Keep it understandable. Documentation should be developed in a language that is commonly known throughout the organization. Leveraging a taxonomy, building a taxonomy, organizations can avoid the complication of using unrecognized terms and slangs. Keep it practicable, regardless of how precise and clear the documentation might be, if it cannot be practiced then it is useless. An example of an unrealistic documentation would be a statement indicating that incident response personnel is to be available 24 hours a day, even though there is no adequate means of contacting them when they are not in the office. For this reason, documentation that is not practicable is not effective and will be quickly ignored. Keep it cooperative. Good governance documentation is developed through the collaborative effort of all relevant stakeholders, such as legal, privacy, security, and human resources. If key stakeholders have not been involved in the development of these documents, it is more likely that problems will arise during its implementation. Keep it dynamic. Useful governance document should be, by design, flexible enough to adapt with organizational changes and growth. It would be impractical to develop documentation that is focused on serving the current needs and desires of the organization without considering what could come in the future. backup and restoration strategies. Even though digital evidence has been put into offline storage for long-term retention, there might come a time when it is needed in support of a business risk scenario, as discussed previously in chapter Define Business Risk Scenarios. When this time comes, it is critical that in addition to the integrity of digital evidence being authenticated, the data itself must also be restored and made readily available so that there is no delay in the investigative process. The recovery time objective (RTO) that an organization accepts for restoring digital evidence from backups is what drives the type of backup strategy that will be implemented. RTO is commonly represented in units of time as minutes, hours, days, or longer depending on the needs for restoring digital evidence. When setting the RTO targets, it is important that organizations realize that lower values will result in more expensive backup solutions than the higher values. Near real-time data replication meeting service levels with this type of backup solution requires that data is synchronously replicated across multiple identical and distributed instances of the storage solution. Because this type of backup strategy requires multiple instances of the storage solution to be highly available for near real-time data clustering, it is considered to be the most expensive, complex, and resource-intensive. Data replication performed on a consistent schedule, this backup solution replicates data to two or more identical and distributed instances of the storage solution. Similar to the requirements of the near real-time strategy, this type of solution still requires the implementation of two or more identical and distributed instances of the storage solution. However, with more moderate RTO targets, this type of backup solution is considered to be just as expensive but slightly less complex and resource-intensive. Data restoration from online backup media with data replication set to occur on a schedule, this backup solution replicates data to highly available online media, such as network-attached storage. Service levels for this type of strategy are reduced to allow for data to be restored into the production storage solution when required, which makes this type of backup solution less expensive, complex, and resource-intensive. Data restoration from offline backup media discussed previously in this chapter, data can be transferred to offline media, such as backup tapes, for long-term storage. This type of backup strategy is the least expensive because it does not have the complexities of implementing additional storage infrastructures. However, the RTO targets for this solution are extremely relaxed because of the time required to restore from offline media. Summary: preserving the authenticity and integrity of digital evidence extends beyond the implementation of technical and physical security controls. Through the implementation of a governance framework that ensures forensic viability right from when data is created, organizations can ensure that legal admissibility of digital evidence is maintained during secure handling and storage. Thanks for watching. Understanding Digital Forensics. Digital forensics is a discipline that must be practiced consistently to ensure the collection, preservation, and presentation of digital evidence is upheld to legal requirements. It is important that the implementation of digital forensics aligns strategically and its contextual usefulness is well understood. Digital forensics has always been labeled as an interesting profession to work in. This comes as no surprise as public interest spikes, fueled by the works of novelists and filmmakers who made the world of digital crime and digital forensic both appealing and stylishly straightforward. But the reality is, there is a lot more discipline to the digital forensic profession than what is portrayed in the media. While it is relatively known that there are legal aspects involved with digital forensics, most people are surprised to learn that the profession involves a great deal of scientific principles, methodologies, and techniques. Not only does digital forensics require a significant amount of specialized training and skills to properly apply these scientific fundamentals, digital forensics is also somewhat of an art form where analytical experience comes into play. Computer crime dates as far back as 1968. In Olympia, Washington, an IBM 1401 data processing system was shot twice by a pistol-toting intruder. Following closely behind in February 1969, the largest student riot in Canada ignited when police were called in to stop a student occupation of several floors of the Hall building at Concordia University. When the police came in, a fire broke out resulting in computer data and university property damages totaling $2 million. The digital forensic community has come a long way since the 1960s. Starting out as a hobby made up mostly of homegrown tools and quite often insufficient processes, we have arrived at a convergence of various law enforcement organizations and intelligence agencies where everybody is following the same consistent principles, methodologies, and techniques. For the most part, digital forensics has become what it is today because of the tactical influences that have consistently driven its development and maturity, such as technology advancements, creation of commercial tools, or the integration with other professions. On the other hand, while the list of strategic influences might be somewhat smaller, the alignment to forensic science and subsequent creation of principles, methodologies, and techniques to abide by has brought about a standardization and formality to the structure of digital forensics. There are also influences that exist as both tactical and strategic realms that should be considered for the future of digital forensics, such as the continued development of the Common Body of Knowledge (CBK) based on research, knowledge, and experiences of the digital forensic community. At the end of the day, the digital forensic investigators of the future will be better trained and educated because the CBK that was established before them will be extensive and readily available. Organizations will need to ensure that they employ digital forensic professionals who are not only accredited to conduct digital forensic investigations but also have strong business and technical qualities. Historically, modern advancements that introduced new ways for technology to be used as either the fruit of Crime 3 or tool of Crime 4 will subsequently lead to an evolution of how digital forensics is used to investigate these crimes. Until recently, cybercrime was traditionally committed with a focus primarily on content, i.e., data exfiltration, and done so with little context, i.e., where attacks are being perpetrated. Naturally, cyber criminals of the future will also be better trained, funded, and organized where the value of their collective efforts will be realized, resulting in heightened situational awareness involving their attacks. To counter the evolving threat landscape, commercial digital forensic tools will need to evolve to where they can easily adapt with the ever-growing volumes of data that needs to be analyzed, further automate known, verified, and validated analytic functions to alleviate manual processing time and reduce error probability, understand and interpret both the content and context of human language and communications for better analytical results, given the fact that some investigations encompass an international scope, such as data residing under multiple jurisdictions, laws and regulations must evolve to enable a global standard for digital forensics. Why is it important? According to Locard's exchange principle, every perpetrator of a crime will bring something into the crime scene and takes something of the crime scene with them. In the digital realm, both of these occurrences can be used as digital evidence in a forensic investigation. The capability of practicing forensically sound principles, methodologies, or techniques within any organization provides an additional defense in depth layer to ensure that potential digital evidence is 1. Acquired in a manner that preserves its integrity, 2. Authenticated to validate that it is identical to the original source data, and 3. Analyzed using techniques and processes that maintain the evidence's integrity. Legal aspects. Even if legal prosecution is not the end goal of the investigation, such as a corporate policy violation, there may be some form of legal action, such as employee termination. It is important that the forensic science principles, methodologies, and techniques are consistently followed because the investigation may wind up in a court of law at some point. Regardless of criminal proceedings, every digital forensic investigation must ensure that an exact copy of digital data is created to ensure no information is lost or overlooked. The authenticity of digital data is preserved through the use of cryptographic algorithms. A chain of custody is established to maintain integrity through the evidence's life cycle. Actions taken by people through the different investigative phases are recorded. Collecting digital evidence from the traditional computer system to modern devices such as mobile phones, game consoles, or virtualized environments, the field of digital forensics encompasses a wide range of technologies that serve as potential evidence sources. While the design and functionality of these technologies is uniquely different, the application of digital forensics involves ensuring the integrity and authenticity are upheld throughout the evidence's life cycle. Two basic types of potential digital evidence that can be gathered from these technologies include non-volatile or volatile data. Volatile data is a type of digital information that is stored within some form of temporary medium that is lost when power is removed. This type of information is an excellent starting point for a forensic investigation because it contains residual data that may be relevant to the processing and analysis of digital evidence that is gathered from non-volatile data sources. The primary source of volatile data can be found inside of random access memory, RAM. Most often, the contents of RAM will contain information relating to frequently used applications, content of recently accessed files, or account information such as usernames and passwords, clear text or hashed. While the type of files containing potential digital evidence can be extensive, depending on the technology, examples of volatile data that are commonly included within the scope of a typical forensic investigation are as follows. Network configurations used by the OS are retrieved from non-volatile data stored on the file system and loaded into RAM for quick and dynamic access, such as Internet Protocol, IP addresses and active network interfaces. Network connections between the local system and remote systems, in any state, i.e., established, listening, listing incoming and outgoing connection properties, such as IP address and local, remote port. Running processes that are currently executing system commands, supporting operational services, or providing user interfaces, such as applications, scripts, or executables. Open files from non-volatile data sources that are actively being accessed by either the system or a user, such as word processing documents, executables, log files. Login sessions containing information about user and/or service accounts currently logged in the system, such as login time, session duration, and authentication attempts, i.e., success, failure. System date time maintains the current date and time information, including time zone and daylight savings properties, that can be used when building a chronology of system events or when correlating the local system events to other system events. Special attention must be given to date time values stored in a system's basic input/output system BIOS, because it can be different than the values contained within the OS configurations. Non-volatile data. Non-volatile data is a type of digital information that is persistently stored within a file system on some form of electronic medium that is preserved in a specific state when power is removed. Contained within a file system is commonly the largest and richest source of potential digital evidence that can be analyzed during a forensic investigation. While the type of files containing potential digital evidence can be extensive, depending on the technology, examples of non-volatile data that are commonly included within the scope of a typical forensic investigation are as follows: account information belonging to users or system processes including the account name, owner, entitlements, group membership, status, and passwords, either in ClearText 5 or as a hash value 6, configuration, log files are used to store various types of system or user settings as well as outputs of auditing information, such as audit records containing records of successful and failed authentication attempts within the system, system event logs used to track the operational actions performed by OS components, such as when the system is booted, application events used to track the operational actions performed by application, such as when a process is executed, data files are used to store information for applications that can be either system-generated or user-generated, such as text files, word processing documents, spreadsheets, databases, audio files, or graphics. Paging swap files are logical files located on a file system that are used by the OS, in combination within RAM, to extend the amount of temporary storage space available on a system so additional data can be dynamically available, such as usernames or password, clear text or hashed. While the contents of these files may resemble or originate from volatile data, the page swap file is non-volatile and is preserved in its last operating state when power is removed. Dump files are used by the OS to automatically store the active contents of RAM when an error condition occurs to assist system administrator in troubleshooting. The resulting files will contain the stored RAM content that is preserved when power is removed. Temporary cache files are files created by either the OS or applications during activities such as installation, upgrades, or normal operations, such as scripts, executables, or web browsing pages. Although such files can be typically deleted at the completion of these activities, this does not always occur, resulting in this data being preserved in its last operating state when power is removed. Hibernation files are created by the OS to record the contents of RAM, running applications, and open files before the system is shut down, so the system state can be restored the next time it boots. Slack space is unused area in between the end of an actual file and the end of the defined storage space, also known as a cluster, 7 available in a file system. When being written to a file system, depending on the volume of data, a file might not occupy the entire cluster, resulting in remaining space otherwise referred to as slack space. In this space, data belonging to other files that previously occupied the cluster but have since been overwritten by a new smaller file are still accessible and can be recovered during a forensic investigation. Registry is a database, specific to the Microsoft Windows platform, which contains important information about the system including, but not limited to, hardware components, installed applications, OS configurations, and account information. While caution should be taken to not make manual changes to the registry because one wrong move can render a system inoperable, the information and potential evidence that reside in the registry make it a significant forensic resource, such as most recently used files, applications configured to automatically run at startup, network shares. Order of volatility. Generally, the more volatile data within a system, the more challenging it is to gather in a forensically sound manner because it is only available for a specific amount of time. Considering the volatile data types listed above, this information can only be gathered from a live system that has not been rebooted or shut down since the incident originally occurred. Therefore, it is critical that investigators are equipped with adequate knowledge of the incident to make an educated decision on whether volatile data should be preserved as part of the forensic investigation. Ideally, the criteria for making this decision should be documented in advance, as part of the organization's standard operating procedures, so investigators can act quickly to preserve the volatile data. The ability to make a decision comes with the inherent risk that the longer it takes to make the decision, the greater the risk that the volatile data will be lost. For instance, every action performed on the system, whether by the system or person, will most certainly alter, in some way, the current state of volatile data available to the investigator. When deciding to preserve volatile data, it is important to keep in mind that the more volatile the data is, the greater there is a need to use specialized individuals and tools to guarantee the data is preserved in a forensically sound manner. Traditionally, digital forensics is performed in response to an incident and focuses on determining the root cause for what prompted the incident. The purpose of performing a digital forensic investigation is to establish evidence and facts from digital information existing on any number of different technologies, e.g., game consoles, mobile devices, computer systems, across dissimilar network architectures, e.g., private, public, cloud, or in varying states, e.g., volatile, static. Since the birth of computer forensics in the 1980s, the application of forensic science has become an underlying foundation that has seen an integration of the consistent principles that support repeatable methodologies and techniques within several other information security disciplines. The application of digital forensic science in other disciplines provides organizations with an acceptable level of assurance that validated and verified processes are being followed to gather, process, and safeguard digital evidence. Examples of disciplines where digital forensic science is used include the following: computer forensics, which relates to the gathering and analysis of digital information as digital evidence on computer systems and electronic storage medium. Network forensics, which relates to the monitoring and analysis of network traffic for the purposes of information gathering, gathering of digital evidence, or intrusion detection. Incident response, which relates to reducing business impact by managing the occurrence of computer security events. Memory forensics, which relates to the gathering and analysis of digital information as digital evidence contained within a system's RAM. Electronic discovery, e-discovery, which relates to the discovery, preservation, processing, and production of electronically stored information, ESI, in support of legal or regulatory litigation matters. Cloud forensics, which relates to the gathering and analysis of digital information as digital evidence from cloud computing systems. As digital forensics continues to evolve alongside of technology advancements, one of the most challenging activities is to ensure that the fundamental principles, methodologies, and techniques are upheld. There is a constant struggle to maintain a balance between collecting digital evidence as efficiently as possible without modifying the integrity of the data in the process. Fortunately, the principles and methodologies of forensic science have been clearly defined and well established, allowing them to be applied relatively seamlessly to any form of digital evidence. Digital Forensic Resources. This book is written from a non-technical, business perspective and is intended for use as an implementation guide to prepare any organization to enhance its digital forensic readiness by moving away from reacting to an incident and becoming proactive with their investigative capabilities. While the basic principles, methodologies, and techniques of digital forensics are covered, this book focuses on outlining, in detail, the where, what, and how an organization can enhance its knowledge, processes, and technologies to implement effective and proactive digital forensic readiness. There are countless resources available today that are designed specifically to teach different basics or specializations contained within the digital forensic discipline. The rise and continued evolution of cybercrime has made a significant contribution to the formation of what digital forensic science is today. Growing out from the pastime of hobbyists, the establishment of forensically sound principles, methodologies, and techniques has turned it into a respected and authoritative discipline. Thanks for watching. www.ifex.org.pk info @ifex.org.pk